1 Kings chapter 17. I'm going to begin with verse 7, and I'm going to read from the NIV. Follow me, please. It says in verse 7, sometime later, the brook dried up, because there had been no rain in the land. Then the word of the Lord came to him. This would be Elijah. Go at once to Zarephath of Sidon and stay there. Stay there. This is a statement that God is giving to Elijah that I wish a lot of Christians understood. And when God says stay, just stay put. Amen. Wait on God.
That's right.
Stay there. Then he says, I have commanded a widow in that place to supply you with food. Now this is interesting. There is a famine in the land. There's nothing to eat. And God does not command someone who is wealthy to feed Elijah. He doesn't command anybody that's got a job to feed him. It's interesting because a widow had absolutely no means of support. Her husband had died. And so she lived off alms or whatever people would give her. But when God speaks to Elijah in the midst of this famine, he doesn't send Elijah to the house of the wealthy. He doesn't even send it to the house of someone that may have some sort of means. He sends Elijah to a house of a widow, a woman that's got nothing to offer. Sometimes, the only way God can get resources to one of his servants is to someone who understands need. Someone that does not understand need may be hardened to this fact. So he sends him to the widow in that place to supply you with food. Verse 10. So he went to Zarephath, and when he came to that town gate, a widow was there gathering sticks.
Come on.
He called to her and asked, would you bring me a little water in a jar so that I may have a drink? As she was going to get it, he called, oh, and by the way, bring me a little piece of bread.
Come on.
Now, please understand, this woman has nothing, close to nothing. And you would think that a man asking for a widow, from a widow, resources, just doesn't jive, it doesn't fit well. But God had already appointed that widow beforehand. And he knew that that widow would supply what that man of God would need. As she was going to get it, he called and bring me a piece of bread. Continuing in verse 2, as surely as the Lord your God lives, she replied, I don't have any bread. Please watch her financial and material condition. By her words, you can learn exactly where she's at. She says, I don't have any bread. Only a handful of flour, a handful. This is a handful. And a jar, and a little oil in a jug. I am gathering a few sticks to take home and make a meal for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die. This is a grievous circumstance. This is a bad circumstance. You ever been in a bad circumstance? And a grievous circumstance? I want you to know something. Sometimes those are the kind of people that God likes to use. Amen. Elijah said, now you would think that Elijah would get it at this point. You would think, my God, I'm asking her for a meal, and she's got nothing. All she has is one meal left for her and her son to die, and that's it. They're going to eat it and die, and it's over. But Elijah knows that the word of God told him that she would supply his need. So he's not going, and please get me here, he's not going based on what he sees. Too many times Christians go based on what they see. He goes based on what God's word told them, not what is in front of him. Listen, folks, we've got a vision. We're going to fill this church with 1,000 people. But if I look around tonight, amen, those are not favorable circumstances. But I want you to know something. We're not going based on what we see. We are going based on what God said. That's the way we believers need to learn to live our lives. Amen. Continuing on, Elijah said in verse 13, don't be afraid. Amen. Don't lose sight of those words. Don't be afraid. Go home and do as you have said. Make a meal for you and your son. But he says, but first, make a small cake of bread for me from what you have and bring it to me. And then make something for yourself and your son. Now, either the man of God doesn't quite grasp it, or he knows exactly what's going on. She just got done telling him, I only have enough for one meal for my son and I, and then we're going to die. He's saying, okay, go do what you said. Make a meal, but bring it to me first, and then you'll make another meal for you and your son. The woman, if she was not in touch with God, and if Elijah was not in touch with God, it would seem like something is wrong here. But they're both aligned in the spirit, and they both know that God is speaking to them concerning this event that is before us. Continuing, please. Verse 14. For this is what the Lord said, the God of Israel. The jar of flour will not be used up, and the jug of oil will not run dry until the day the Lord gives rain on the land. There's a famine here. She went away and did as Elijah had told her. So there was food every day. Grab that. There was food every day for Elijah and for the woman and for the family. When you step out in faith, God will meet you there. Amen. There was food for Elijah, for the woman, and the family. And here is the reason why. For the jar of flour was not used up, and the jug of oil did not run dry, in keeping with the word of the Lord spoken to Elijah. You've got two events. You've got two things before you. Circumstances and the word of God. What report will we believe? The doctor's report or the word of the Lord? Would you believe what's inside your refrigerator and your bank account? Or are you going to believe the word of the Lord? Are you going to believe what you see in front of you? Or are you going to believe the word of the Lord? The word of the Lord never fails. I'm going to minister tonight for a few moments on the topic, lessons from a widow. Lessons from a widow. I had thought to entitle this message, Lessons from Zarephath. But as I was walking in to the church this evening, the Lord spoke to me. He says, the lessons did not come from Zarephath, it came from a widow. And so tonight I'm going to ask you to pray with me. Father, in Jesus' name, anoint this message. Anoint my lips. Anoint every ear that they may hear your word and be encouraged by your word. We ask for the anointing of the Holy Ghost, the direction of the Holy Spirit as we deliver this word. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Give the Lord a big praise offering. Let me set before you the backdrop of why this is going on. Elijah, who is the prophet of God, has taken a stand against Israel. Ahab was the king. Elijah said, for 3.5 years, there will be no rain as a judgment of God. Now, you may or may not understand the ramifications of having no rain. We understand that too much rain could be detrimental. Take a good look at Houston and you will find out what too much rain can cause. Well, having no rain creates quite the opposite. Things were dying. There was no livestock, no grass to feed the livestock. It was a domino effect. Everything is dying. It got to a point where people became cannibals. They were eating one another. This is how bad this scene is. The cause of this drought was Ahab. Although Ahab, who was the king, Elijah judged the nation because of the king's sin, but people did not understand that side of it. Everybody knew that it was Elijah who caused the drought by speaking no rain for 3.5 years. So Elijah was the most hated individual in Israel. Because it was because of him, according to what people saw, that caused this great drought. Everything was dying. Everything was withering. The ground was parched. Nothing was producing. Elijah was hated. And so God tells Elijah at some point to go, amen, to the east of Jordan. And he says, go there and I'm going to cause, this is prior to our text, I'm going to cause ravens to feed you, and you're going to drink water from a brook. So Elijah spends some time at the brook. He's drinking from the brook. Ravens are feeding him. But then the word of God makes a tremendous statement in verse 7 and 8. It said, sometime later, the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. So now you've got here, Elijah also is in a bad predicament. Continuing with verse 8, it said, then the word of the Lord came to him, and he said, go, leave the brook, and go to Zarephath.
Come on.
So this is where the whole scene takes place. As I minister tonight for a few moments on lessons from a widow, there are 4 principles that I learned from this widow, which I think may be beneficial to you as a child of God. Number 1 is this. Our release sets in motion God's release. Let me say it again. Our release will set in motion God's release. Meaning, God acts in response to our actions. See, God normally won't do anything that you're not willing to do yourself. There's an old saying that is not biblical, but I hear quite often, that God helps those who help themselves. Even though that is not a biblical statement, nonetheless, it's a true statement. Because our release sets in motion God's release. Look what Jesus, now, the opposite is also true. Our withhold sets in motion God's withhold. If we release, God releases.
Right.
If we withhold, God withholds.
Come on.
We have a lot of potential in what we do. Amen. In Matthew 18, verse 18, I want you to draw your attention to that, please. This is the words of Jesus. He said, whatever you bind on earth, watch this, withhold. Whatever you withhold on earth will be withheld in heaven. And whatever you release or loose on the earth will be loose in the heavens. What is Jesus saying? That how we release It's the same way it's released in heaven. And how we withhold is the same way is withheld in heaven. This will apply to every area of our lives. If you refuse to forgive your neighbor, watch this, the Lord will refuse to forgive you. Our release. Look at Matthew 6:15, the words of Jesus. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father in heaven will not forgive you your sins. Why? Our release sets in motion God's release. You can go on. Even in the area of finances. The Bible says this. Jesus himself said in Luke 6:38, give. That's the release. Give, release, and it will be released or given to you. Amen. He says, a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, will be poured into your lap. Now watch what he says. For with the measure that you release, with the same measure that you release, the Father will release unto you, and men will release unto you. What am I saying? Our release, amen, sets in motion God's release. We know Malachi bring the tithe into the storehouse, and then it, God releases the windows of heaven to bless you. Scripture gives us many examples concerning this. Moses had first to strike the river Nile before the waters turned to blood. Moses had to release, he had to take the first step before God met at the second step. You can go on with Peter. Peter had to step out of the boat before he can walk on the water with Jesus. You can go to the woman at Zarephath. All she has is a little oil and a little flour. And she says, I've got only enough for my son and I. We're going to eat one meal and we're going to die. So what did she do? She released it. And as she released it, bam, God released what he had in his hands. Amen. I'm telling you, verse 15, she went away and did as Elijah told her. There are two words here. She did. Her doing opened the doorway for the Lord to set in motion that which he wanted to bless her with.
Yes.
Number two, talking about lessons from a widow. Number two, a seed released becomes a harvest. A seed withheld remains a seed. I'm going to say this again. A seed released becomes a harvest. A seed withheld remains a seed, excuse me. Consider with me closely Jesus' words found in John 12:22 for note takers. Look what Jesus said. Verily, verily, or truly I say to you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only what? A single seed. Watch this. He said, unless the seed falls into the ground, and that seed, unless you release the seed and let that seed fall into the ground, that seed will always remain only a single seed. He said, but, I love it when the Lord says, but the seed, watch this, but if it dies, if it's released and it dies, what does it do? It produces many seeds or a harvest. What is Jesus saying? He's saying that a seed, once it's released, it becomes a harvest. But if you withhold the seed, it remains a seed as long as you withholding.
Wow.
Let me bring it down to layman's terms. Everything God created is a harvest in seed form. Let me say this again.
Yeah.
Everything God created is a harvest in seed form. A watermelon, I love watermelon. My wife brought one home the other day from the market. But a watermelon is a harvest in a seed form. An apricot is a harvest. Listen, when you go to the market and you buy one apricot, it's not a seed. It's a harvest that you hold in your hand. An apricot is a harvest in seed form. An orange is a harvest in seed form. You are a harvest in seed form. What are you talking about, Pastor? Listen, the Word of God, follow me. The Word of God is a harvest in seed form.
Come on.
Allow me to explain it through Scripture. Look what Jesus said in Luke 18:11. The seed is the Word of God. Jesus is saying that the Word of God, get this, is seed. That's Luke 8:11. And if you go down a few verses, then he adds this to it in verse 15. But the seed on good soil stands for those with a noble good heart who hear the word. What's the word? Someone say seed.
Seed.
Who hear the word and by persevering produce a crop or a harvest. Now, let me bring it down again a little lower. Amen. Jesus is saying that the Word of God is seed. And when you throw that Word out, those that receive it diligently, he says, that seed will produce in them a harvest, a crop. So what does that mean to you and me? That in your mouth, there is a harvest. Inside of your mouth, there is a harvest in seed form. That when you go to the supermarket and you run across somebody and you begin to share the Word of God with them, what you're really doing is you are spewing a harvest out of your mouth. And that harvest is coming out in the form of a seed because the Word of God is seed. What do you think I'm doing right now? Right now, I'm sending out a harvest. I'm speaking harvest in seed form. I'm declaring the Word of God. Now, go further with me, please. The kingdom of, this is, by the way, this is what Paul said. He said, I planted the seed. Apollos watered the seed. What seed is he talking about? The Word of God. He says, I planted it in believers. Now, please, look over here for a moment. Paul is saying, I took the seed of God's Word, I spoke it, and by speaking it, I planted it in believers.
Right. Come on.
Apollos came around, and he watered the seed that I planted as a farmer. He said, but it was God who made the seed grow, and God turned a seed into a crop or a harvest.
Amen. Come on. Praise God.
So when you witness to your family members, remember this. All you're doing is you are speaking harvest in seed form. Now, let's go further. The kingdom of God is a harvest in seed form. In Jesus' parable of the mustard seed, look what he says in Matthew 13:31-32. He says, the kingdom of heaven is like what? A mustard seed, which a man took. Follow this, please. Get in between the lines. A man took and he planted in the field. Though it was the smallest of seeds, yet when it grows, It is the largest garden plants and becomes a tree so that birds come and perch on its branches. Jesus is saying that the kingdom of God is this, is one who sowed the word of God. He sowed the harvest in seed form, and that word grew and grew so much that it became the largest that birds came to perch on that tree. Inside of your mouth lies the potential to change entire communities. You can change your entire household by what you speak. Amen. There is power in your words. There is power in what we declare. Because inside of my mouth, there is a harvest in seed form.
Come on.
This is why when you see people that always talk negative, they produce a harvest. When you speak to people that are positive, they produce a positive harvest. Why? Because inside of your mouth, bless God, amen, there is power to change things.
Come on, praise God.
Now, our possessions are also harvest in seed form.
That's right.
We can see this clear from the woman at Zarephath. She didn't have much. She had a little oil and a little flour. But it was a harvest in seed form. And the minute she sowed it into the man of God, what came back? A harvest. You gotta ignore the quantity of what you have. Because you have to pay attention to the quality of what you have. You have power in your words. Verse 15, please. It says, she went away, did as Elijah told her, so there was food every day for Elijah, for the woman, and her family. For the jar of flour was not used up, and the jug of oil did not run dry, in keeping with the word spoken by Elijah. So there was in her house flour and oil. Doesn't look like much. Doesn't look like it's got much potential. But what she did not realize till the man of God got there is that that little oil and that little flour was enough to produce a harvest. Amen. You may have 5 nickels to your name. But I want to tell you something. 5 nickels have the power to produce a financial harvest if you sow it right. Amen. Your marriage may be on the rocks, but I want to tell you something. If you sow your marriage the right way, your marriage is a harvest. And if you sow it the right way, number 3. And by the way, our lives is a harvest in seed form.
Right.
My life is a harvest in seed form.
God.
Number 3. Please grab these principles from a widow at Zarephath. Fear disposes opportunities afforded by faith. I'm going to say that again. This may take you a little time to register. Fear disposes opportunity afforded by faith. What does that mean? Fear aborts opportunity that faith affords. Let me say that again. And these are not quotes that we got from anyone. These are quotes that we got straight from the hot cake of heaven. Amen. Fear aborts the opportunity that faith affords. Let me take it a little further to try to create some understanding. Faith says, sow what you have and believe God for the harvest. Fear says, hold on to what you got and don't you let it go. Let me say that again. Faith and wait for the harvest.
Come on.
Fear says, stupid, you better keep those two nickels because it's all you got. What am I saying? Fear will dispose the opportunity that faith affords. The woman at Zarephath could have easily aborted her blessing if she would have gave way to fear. She would have aborted it. And I've seen destinies aborted because people can't wait on God by faith.
Come on.
This is why Elijah had to encourage her. He says in verse 13, he goes, go make me a cake. And then he says, Elijah said to her, but don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Imagine, you've got to put yourself in her shoes. She's got one meal left. She's going to eat it for her and her son, and she's going to die. Elijah said, listen, forget about you and your son. Go make me a torta, and you come back. And when you give me a torta, you're going to have more to eat on. Imagine the thoughts that are running through her mind. Imagine that. All I've got is one left. What if he's not the man of God? What if it's just a guy playing a number on me to take advantage of me, which I'm sure there was a lot of swindlers back then, amen. What if this doesn't work? Oh, watch out now. What if this doesn't work, amen? God told you to do something, and you have to go out on the limb, and fear comes to visit, and fear tells you, what if this doesn't work, amen? She must have gone through all of that, but she obeyed the word of the Lord, and Elijah had to tell her, why? Because fear aborts opportunities that faith affords. Look at verse 13. Elijah said to her, don't be afraid. Go home and do as you have said. He's telling her, go home and make a cake for you. Please understand the jargon that the man of God uses. He says, don't be afraid. Go home and do what you have said. What did she say? I have one more meal for me and my son. He says, go home and do what you have said. But then Elijah drops the bomb. She's walking away. He's saying, go home, do what you have said. Make a meal for you and your son. And as she's going there, he says, oh, but first. What do you mean? First make me a cake. It's like she was leaving in hope. She hears a word, but first she turns around. First what? Make me a cake. How many know that's not easy to do? How many know it's not easy to tithe, amen, when you got nothing left in the bank account? How many know, amen, it's not easy to hand out somebody something when you got nothing yourself, amen? That's what I'm talking about. Fear will dispose what faith is trying to create. Queen Esther was faced with the same predicament. You know the story. The Jews were in threatened to be extinct. And her uncle told her, you know, go and present yourself to the king. It was unlawful. You were not supposed to do that. You cannot enter the king's chambers during that season. And so she was bold, man. She says, you know, I know what fear tells me. Fear tells me if I walk in there, it's my head on the platter. He says, but I'm going to go by faith of what God wants to do for these people.
Wow.
And I like it wording. She says, go gather. She tells her uncle, go gather all the Jews that are in Susa and fast for me. Do not drink or eat for 3 days or 3 nights. He says, I and my attendants will fast as you do also. And then she makes this tremendous statement. She says, when this is done, I will go to the king. And even though it is against the law, if I perish, I perish. What is she doing, man? She's saying, you know, I'm not going to obey fear. I'm not going to obey what I see before me. I'm not going to obey the circumstances. She says, you know what? I'm going to go for it because fear will dispose what God is trying to give me by faith. The three Hebrew children in the fiery furnace was no different story. They were thrown in there. And they said to the king, even if the Lord doesn't deliver us, we still will not bow down to you. This is what we need in the church today. People that allow, amen, that walk by faith and not by sight. Amen. Fourth and final, I close with this thought. Sacrificial faith is the fuel that ignites a miracle. I'm going to say that again. Sacrificial faith is the fuel that ignites a miracle. How many need a miracle in this building? Amen. Hallelujah. You need a miracle in your life. Praise God. You know what you need? You need not to be focusing on the miracle. You need to be focusing on sacrificial faith. Because it's sacrificial faith that will fuel, amen, and ignite the miracle. How can you say that, preacher? I've got nothing. Well, there's stories in the Bible with people with nothing. Yeah. A mother who sent a boy to the store to pick up 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish.
Come on.
It's all he had. Jesus is standing before 5,000 people.
Come on.
They're all hungry. He can hear their stomachs grumbling. He turns to one of his disciples and he says, why don't you get him something to eat? There was nothing to eat nowhere in sight. His smart disciple says, Lord, even if we have money to feed this many people, by the way, it was 5,000. Most scholars believe it was over 20,000 when you consider women and children, which were not counted because in that culture, women and children didn't matter much. So he turns to his disciples and says, go get them something to eat. His disciple says, Lord, even if we did, even if we had the money, it's too far. They would starve by the time we got back. He says, but there is a boy. He's got 5 loaves and 2 fish. But what? I love the disciples' word. But what is that among so many? What is that among? You see how the word of God parallels from Old to New Testament and it never changes its train of thought, amen. The same way this woman, all she had was a little oil and a little flour. This boy, all he's got is 5 loaves and 2 fish and 20,000 people before him.
Come on. Wow.
So he's got to do something. If those people are going to eat, that boy's got to sacrifice his 5 loaves and 2 fish. Why? Because sacrificial faith is the fuel that ignites the embers of miracle.
Wow, come on, praise God.
Abraham, another good story. God tells him, take your one and only son to Mount Moriah, and when you get there, sacrifice him to me. Wow. Now imagine that. Walks 3.5 days, if I'm not mistaken. He gets there, and his boy says, you know, Dad, we got the fire, we got the wood, we got the knife, but where's the sacrifice? And he looks at him and says, you're it. Amen. You're it, buddy. It's you who we're going to kill tonight. His only son. He knew that. Listen, church, Abraham knew that it was not going to be a sheep. He believed, the Bible says, I believe in Hebrew, he believed that even if he killed his son, and God's obedient in an attempt to obey God, that God would resurrect his son.
Right.
He had faith.
Yeah.
And so he's going only on faith. When you got nothing to go on, put some faith in the tank. Amen. Put a little faith in the tank.
Praise God.
He had nothing. Our problem is when we get a little something, we don't need faith anymore.
Oh, come on.
But when you got nothing, you need faith.
Oh, yeah.
So he's going up there with his son. He's going to kill him. He's obeying God. You know the story, amen. And so what happens, amen? See, he was sacrificing his son. Sacrificial faith fuels and ignites a miracle. From that event, Abraham became the father of nations.
Praise God. Praise God. Wow.
The woman at Zarephath was no different.
That's right.
The minute she released that meal to the man of God, a miracle was done. And there is something powerful with the Lord that when we begin to release, God releases. Look at verse 15 and 16 as I close. Worship team, you may come. She went away and did as Elijah had told her. So there was food every day for Elijah. See, Elijah, man, praise God. The man of God knew what he was doing. He was eating every day. There was food every day for Elijah and for the woman and for her family. For the jar of flour had not been used up. The jug of oil did not run dry. In keeping with the Lord, with the word spoken of the Lord to Elijah or by Elijah.
Praise God. Hallelujah.
I was 24 years old. I can tell you this story like it was yesterday. I had no job. I had an automobile that I could not pay that had been repoed. You ever had a repoed car? Amen. I have one. I was 24 years old. Thank God 7 years is all cleared up. Wasn't saved. Wasn't born again. I didn't grow up, amen, like my wife. She grew up in a nice home, praise God. I grew up in a nice home, but we weren't taught those things properly. There were too many of us. And I remember being invited. I wasn't born again yet. I remember being invited to East LA College there to a conference. It's Praise Chapel. On the way out the door, I borrowed my father's Toyota. It was a little, nice little yellow Toyota. As I'm leaving the house, we lived in Bell Gardens at the time. I'm driving off to East LA College, where we had conferences at one time. As I'm driving out, my mother hands me $20. She says, "Here, son, $20, you can eat something when you get out of the church." She really wanted me to go to church. I was heartbroken. My life had turned upside down. Some people think, "Well, Pastor, you were always born blessed." No, you have no idea. Amen. You have no idea. I drove to the conference and I was sitting, there must have been 1,000 people in that conference. I was sitting way in the back of that auditorium. And there was a preacher by the name of Joe Machaca who had a cowboy hat. And he was taking up the offering. And he made this statement. He says, "There's somebody here, and all you've got..." I needed a miracle, folks, but I needed a miracle. He says, "All you've got is $20 in your pocket. You've got no job. You got nowhere to go." He says, "But God is telling me to tell you to sacrifice that $20 and God will do the miracle." Now, there was 1,000 people in that room. I thought immediately, well, I can't be the only one in East LA with $20 in my pocket. I'm sure. And now, if I was at Beverly Hills Church, it might be different, but I was positive I could not be the only one at East LA College in a room with 1,000 people that had only $20 in their pocket. So I thought to myself, I reasoned, and I said, "Can't be me. Can't be me." I wasn't filled with the Holy Ghost yet. But I can feel something on the inside of me telling me, "He's talking to you. He's talking to you. He's talking to you." You ever try to put that voice out of your head? Because all I'm hearing is King Taco. King Taco. After church, King Taco. King Taco. And then there's another voice saying, "Give it up. He's talking to you. He's talking to you." And I'm battling. You know, Paul says, I'm battling back and forth. I was battling against dropping the 20 or going to King Taco. The offering basket goes by, and guess what I did? Nothing. I just watched it go right past me. Got in my car, not my car, my dad's car, and drove all the way home on the 605 freeway, all the way back home to Bell Gardens. I walk in through the front door of my house, and my mother says, "How was conference?" I said, "It was horrible." She says, what do you mean? Were you in church? I said, I was. But it was horrible. She says, why? I said, you remember the 20 you gave me? She said, yeah. I felt God telling me to give it up, and I didn't. I brought it all the way back home. She said, what are you going to do? I said, there's only one thing I can do. I'm driving back. I asked my father if I could borrow the car, got back in the Toyota, and drove back on the 605 all the way to East LA. When I got there, everybody was gone. I said to myself, well, I've done what I was supposed to do. I've relieved my guilt. Amen. As I'm turning around to go back home, I look to my right, and guess who's standing there on the corner in the dark of that empty parking lot? Whom other than the cowboy who took the offering? The Lord told me, I didn't know it was the Lord then. He says, what are you going to do? He said, well, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm not going back home with criminal money and stolen money. So I drove up to that man, parked the car, went out. I said, mister, I don't know who you are. You don't know who I am. But you were taking the offering tonight. I was sitting way in the back. You said, somebody here's got 20 bucks. And I know you were talking about me. And I'll tell you one thing. I drove all the way home. I didn't feel good. I drove all the way back. I've got this 20 in my pocket. I pulled it out. I said, sir, here's the $20. I don't want this guilty money. I put it in his hand and drove back home. As I'm driving home, I am the happiest guy in the world. I'm $20 shy. I've got nothing. My pockets are empty. I've got nothing. But I'm much more happier now than when I had the 20. I've got it. See, years later, I met Pastor Joe Macharga. And I told him, hey, you remember me? He says, yeah, I remember. You're the guy that approached me in the parking lot. Now, I've been saved for a few years now. I said, what did you ever do with that 20 bucks? He says, we went out and got some pizza. You know what problem we got in the church tonight? Is that we got to know everything. You know what I said in my heart? And I've done this for the last 35 years of my salvation. It was God who told me to give it.
Right.
And what God does with it is his business.
Right.
Not mine.
Amen.
You don't need to tell me what you did with it. It's God's business. 35 years we've been given like that. And we continue.
Right.
Because my job, my responsibility is simple. Obey God. What a sacrifice that was. What a tremendous sacrifice. But I'll tell you, I'll close right here. I told you that I needed a miracle. I can't tell you what that miracle was because it'll take too long. The following week, I received the miracle that I needed. The exact following week. And God has not stopped doing miracles in my life since then. What am I saying? Sacrificial faith is the fuel that ignites a miracle. When God talks to you, obey Him. When God says do this, doesn't matter how hard it is, do it. Do it. Because all that God is trying to do, He's trying to usher in a blessing into your life. Who knows what happened to that woman at Zarephath? I don't know what happened to her, but I thank God that tonight we've learned lessons from a widow at Zarephath. Would you stand to your feet, please? We're going to sing.